In this video, we're going to learn the differences between the entry point and CMD instructions in Dockerfiles. Then we're going to take a look at a few practical examples of the most common use cases for one or the other. So let's get started. By the way, if you don't know how to create Dockerfiles or you just need a refresher, check out my step-by-step Dockerfile tutorial. I'll link it up here and in the video description. In Dockerfiles, both the entry point and CMD instructions are used to specify commands the container is supposed to run when starting up. So, whether we end our Dockerfile with CMD, some command, or entry point, some command, it produces the exact same result. But what's the difference then? The first thing to know about these two instructions is that they can be used both in the same Dockerfile. If you put multiple CMD instructions or multiple entry points, only the last one will take effect. But if you use a CMD in combination with an entry point, they will both be taken into account when running a container. Let's learn what happens with an example. If we have a Docker file with CMD command 1, when we run the image with docker run my container, Docker will create a new container and immediately execute command 1. We also know that we can change this behavior by specifying a different command after the image name and override the CMD instruction in the Docker file, i.e. docker run my image, CMD2, will run a new container with the CMD2 command. When we introduce an entry point, Docker will behave a little differently. It will first look at the command defined in the entry point, and then use whatever we have in the CMD as additional option for that command. So, a Docker run in this case will result in the execution of entry point 1, parameter 1, parameter 2. Notice how these are not two commands chained together. When both are provided, entry point will be the command, and whatever is specified as CMD will be interpreted as additional options. What's special about the entry point is that if additional arguments are passed at the end of the Docker run, these will not change the container entry point. If we execute docker run my container CMD2, the new container will start with the command entry point CMD2. The entry point is transparent to the user, and can only be overridden by explicitly passing the entry point argument to Docker run. Defining an entry point for your Docker files can be a double-edged sword. From the developer perspective, it is a powerful way to make sure a command runs transparently at container startup. On the other hand, you can really confuse your users if you're hiding too much logic there. So, when should you use a CMD and when the entry point? The short answer is that you should always use CMD in your Docker files, unless your container has to execute a certain command every time. In that case, you can introduce an entry point. Using CMD is the easiest and more flexible solution because it allows user to override the entire startup command just by appending it to the Docker run instruction. For the long answer, I want to show you two real-world scenarios where the entry point is necessary. We'll see how to package a command line utility in a Docker container, and how to create a wrapper function and force the container to run as the non-root user. I recently needed to run DNS queries to investigate a network issue on my Mac. I know how to do that in Linux with a dig command, but I didn't know if it was available for macOS. So I thought to package dig in a container. To do so, I can create a very simple Docker file. Let's use Debian as a base image, and then install DNS util package with apt. DNS utils will include the dig utility. I will build a container and tag it as DNS utils, so I can run a DNS query on google.com with docker run DNS utils dig google.com. Even though it works just fine, I don't like writing long comments, so I can use the entry point to my advantage and make dig transparent to the user. I just need to add an entry point at the end of the Docker file and tell it to run dig as my container command. I'll build a container again and use dig as the image name, so now I can run docker run dig and still specify command line arguments. Let me try a few. I can type docker run dig minus -h to show the help page, or do a DNS lookup with docker run dig docker.com. If you really can't stand typing docker run every time, you can even create a command line alias in your bash.c file. Add alias dig equal to docker run dig, and now your shell will replace that for you. Isn't that great? Let's take a look at the second more complex use case now. By the way, if you'd like to follow along with the tutorial and try this out yourself, you can pause the video and download these examples. I have linked the repository page in the video description. Running containers as the super user can leave your services vulnerable to attacks. But there are cases where you need root privileges at runtime. Let's say, for instance, we have a containerized application that produces data, like a database, and store it in a volume. In this case, we want to make sure that when we mount the data volume, the non-root user in the container can read and modify all files in that directory before starting the service. In this example, we have created a simple bash script that generates 5 unique IDs and appends them into a file in the data volume. To follow best practices, this container runs the generator.sh script as appUser instead of root. This can be an issue if something else tampers with the file ownership in the volume, and appUser can no longer modify the keys.txt file. To demonstrate, I can simply run the container as root once. I'll create a new empty volume with the docker volume create keys volume, and run the container as root the first time. Docker run -v, we mount the keys volume into the slash data directory, run as the root user, and the container name. If I now run this a second time as non-root, the user won't have permissions to write the file. To solve this issue, we can create a wrapper script so that if we run the container as root, it will fix file permissions and then lower privileges to run the container command as appUser. Let's create a new file called entrypoint.sh in the same directory as our Docker file and add the following script: exec and then $at between double quotes. The $at is a shell script notation to replace all command line parameters. And we know that whatever is defined as CMD in the Docker file will translate to additional parameters for the entry point. Let's also echo the command we are executing to see what is happening. We save this file for now and edit the Docker file, where we can add the entry point to run this new script. If we now build the UID gen container and run with Docker, run UID gen ls-l/data, we can see our echo instruction from the entry point telling us we are going to list all the files in the data directory. And clearly, permission on the keys files are wrong, because we need appUser to be the owner of the files. To fix it, let's go back to our entrypoint.sh and add the following. We check if the current user running the container is root. If it is, we know we need to fix file permissions by making appUser the owner for the data directory and all files in it. Then we need to run the container command as the appUser. For that, we can use the gosu command. Then specify the user we want to lower privileges to. And finally, the command to run. We close the if statement and save the file. After building the container, we simply need to run our key generator as non-root user once. And the keys have been generated successfully this time. To make sure we are indeed running as non-root, we can start the container and print the current user. Notice how even if I ask Docker to run the container as root, the current user is appUser. And if we list the data directory again, appUser is now the owner of the keys.txt file. In this video, we looked at the differences between CMD and EntryPoint in Dockerfiles and practiced using them. I hope you learned something interesting with this tutorial. If you enjoyed it, please support my channel by subscribing and smashing that like button. If you have any question, don't think twice and drop me a comment down below. I would love to hear your feedbacks. Thank you so much for watching and see you in the next video.